like you're looking through a telescope. You see where you're gonna be. Hello and welcome to We Are DeKalb TV. I'm your host, Heidi B. Fuller, and we have an exceptional show for you here today. Thanks for joining us here on Channel 25, where we can be aired every Tuesday from 4 to 5. Thank you for joining us here on We Are DeKalb TV. Stick around for more great fun. Welcome back to We Are DeKalb TV. I'm your host, Heidi Fuller, and as promised, we have some great guests for you here today. Today we have Mr. William Michael Barbee, business owner, entrepreneur, author, and we also have Mr. James Womack. But we'd like to start with Mr. Barbee. Mr. Barbee, thank you so much for joining us here today on We Are DeKalb TV.
Thank you for having me.
I understand that you've done quite a few things in your lifetime.
To say the least.
Well, let's start off with talking about what would be the best starting point. Would you like to start off with your book or just a little bit about your past?
I think in order to best sum up what the book is about or how it came into existence, it's good to talk about the past.
Okay, let's start there.
I'm a city of Newark, New Jersey kid, public school system, grew up on the lower income bracket, had many challenges, social, economical, and went through a whole array of issues from depression and suicidal depressions and institutionalized for depression. So,
you know, I read in your bio about your depression. How does that all come about, or when do you really recognize that you're depressed and not just going through a low period?
Well, for me, and I can only speak for myself,
when
I went through the experiences of that dark part of my childhood, you recognize the difference between depressed or going through some transition when you can't find your way out. And I found myself continuing in a downward spiral.
Now, about how old were you? Because you said when you were a child.
I would have to say, not really understanding or being able to title it depression, it started as early as 14.
Wow.
At the age of, actually 13.
Okay.
At the age of 13, my family was displaced as a result of a fire that we had. Being low income and degree of ignorance, to say the least, no ill intent. But they didn't have insurance on their items, the property. Therefore, we lost everything we ever owned. And at that time, at the age of 14, going into high school, and went to a competitive high school, School of Performing Arts, Arts High School, I had to compete with kids who may have had both parents with their childhood belongings. So for me, I remember my first month of going to school, I wore my neighbor's shirt, my neighbor's pants.
Wow.
Goodwill and Salvation Army became the recreational stores.
Okay.
So that, during that transitional period of my life, adolescence, was a very tough time for me. And being young and going through these developments, you have girls.
Yes.
You know, your hormones are
your puberty and all those other great things. Oh, yeah.
So when you're dealing with all those things, and now you have to look at self. Your esteem is damaged, and you have other issues that come into play.
When you talked about being displaced, were you actually homeless at that time, or did you guys have a place to sleep? I mean, well, you know what I mean.
Well, Salvation Army, once you have your fire, they put you up in a welfare hotel. And we stayed at the Lincoln Motel in the city of East Orange, New Jersey. Not to really put such a damper on that, because had it not been for the Salvation Army, it, you know, no telling where we would have been.
Yes.
They provided service for us for over, I believe, around 2 months. Often when I speak to kids today, I bring up that story because hardships is something we're all going to face. But today, 30 years later, I own the office building directly across the street from the welfare hotel in which I live. So I'm always speaking positivity in spite of whatever hardships I've faced in life.
That's awesome. So you never know where you'll end up, I'm sure.
You know, and again, so, you know, when we look at life and even the book, there's always a story behind each face. And that's why platforms like this is good for authors, business owners, people who have succeeded in some areas, where they can come address issues that, you know, far too often we look at the external man and we look at the polished person rather than what it took to get to where you are.
Absolutely.
So I speak openly about being depressed or going through those transitions in which I had to encounter.
Well, at 14, siblings, brothers, sisters?
I'm the youngest of five, and we're only 1 year apart.
Okay, so all of you guys were in this
We all, and actually, you know, even adding to that, not only were we displaced, you're dealing with a family, a nucleus of seven individuals who no longer lived under the same roof as a result of that one fire.
Wow.
So I never once lived with my eldest sister, my eldest brother, or my middle sister. We began to live after Salvation Army funding ran out. We began to live in relatives, attics, basements, sofas, you know, until you really felt as if you weren't wanted, even though people were trying their best to help you. So for 2 years, we were
all over the place.
All over the place. And then we ended up moving into a one bedroom with maybe five adults or teenagers and two adults.
One bathroom.
One bathroom. Didn't even have a tub. It was a shower.
Wow.
So I really can appreciate who I am today.
Absolutely.
And the struggle it took to get to where I am now. Mm-hmm. So when I'm hit with different things and the successes are rolling, I understand by which it comes, you know, and I give all praise to God.
Thereby by the grace of God.
There
That's
you
awesome.
Go.
Yes. So your siblings now, are you guys still very close?
Oh, we're very close. Actually, two of my sisters are here in Atlanta. I travel here for business. The different businesses that we have that I'm sure we'll discuss. But I'm very close to every one of my siblings.
So going back to school, how were you at 14? Let's start there. Share with us that journey.
Well, it was rough. You know, one year in your first week, you're going to school, you're still smelling like smoke because you're in a welfare hotel. And not only that, you know, you lost all your belongings. Back then, within our community, I know as I was growing up, being a man of a darkened complexion, you know, we had names that we called one another, and I was always called that dark one. And being young and nappy head, as we would deem it, and all those other things, I started going down into a low self-image. I really didn't get that grasp called love of self. I still went to church. I still was an usher.
Okay.
Still did my Sunday school, read my Bible. But even with all of that, you know, I heard a preacher preach recently when God isn't there. And it was just a twist that he was putting on the message. And it's not that God isn't there, it's when you can't recognize him.
Say it.
When he's present. And at that age, I had to go through those transitions. And sometimes it's rough.
Especially at that age.
Yeah, it was very rough. And then from there, having to go and begin working illegally to help support the family. And then I remember, you know, I remember as a kid, we always went to nice stores. But as a result of the fire, I became the king of secondhand stores.
All right.
Furniture came from Goodwill. I love Goodwill. Okay. Even to this day, I support Salvation Army, Goodwill, different organizations that have supported me throughout my life.
You know, there are two great ministries, and
yes,
people don't know that the Salvation Army was birthed from an opportunity to help, to save the people, to save the world, that type thing. So you're in high school now. Did you play any athletes, any sports?
Well, I tried out for the baseball team, but the problem with that, I still had to go to work. I tried out for track, and I stayed on the track team maybe two seasons. But it conflicted with the fact that I needed to work. And me not understanding the importance of after-school activities for kids of that age versus working, because you're not really making dollars. I think the person who I am today is birthed out of a young kid who was trained and began to understand or take on the understanding that I need to work in order to make it.
Okay.
So my success today being an owner of seven businesses is a result of
your work ethic.
14 years of age and this work ethic. So there's a curse with it, and then there's the many blessings that come with it. So I accept the crosses that I have to bear.
Wow. You've been through quite a bit.
I've been through a lot, but many other people have
been through
worse.
More, yeah.
You know?
Let's talk about graduation.
Graduation from high school. I went to, again, the School of Performing Arts, Arts High School in the city of Newark. It's a competitive school. Today we have magnet schools. Then it wasn't a magnet school. You had three schools in the city of Newark. You had Science High, you had arts high school and you had university high. Mm-hmm. And all of them, you had to have academics that excel beyond the average kid. You had to qualify. Wow. Inside the high school for the freshman class, there were only 150 slots. Mm-hmm. So you had tens of thousands of kids in the city applying for that. So I'm honored to have been chosen as one of those 150.
Absolutely.
Upon graduation, I went on to, I was a fine artist, I painted.
Because I was going to ask you, what was your skill?
I painted. Actually, Tisha Campbell went to my high school. She was 2 years in back of me. Mm-hmm. And we're friends today. I remember Tisha.
Very talented.
Yeah, very talented in school. Beautiful young lady. But I was an artist, I painted, and that was my passion. And as an artist, you have this innate ability that God speaks through
you.
And that's the way I've always saw it. You know, you see beauty in some of everything, so.
Yeah, I was reading in your bio that you see beauty.
Yeah, I really believe that, you know. Often, and it's so funny, when I get resumes on my desk for different positions, I usually let the other staff, the senior management in the organization, review the resumes. And they know, my senior management know I don't like looking at resumes, because when you look at them, you know, it's all, you know, exaggerated stories.
Right.
You know, so. But with high school, at the conclusion, I went on to college.
Okay.
I applied to art school, got in different art schools, but consider my financial instability, I didn't know how we would pay for it. And I never once thought to seek advice from my parents for some odd reason. And I ended up going to a local school, Jersey City State, and I majored in art there. I didn't find art to be challenging at all.
So it just came to you naturally?
Came naturally, and then the school that I had gone to, Arts High School, prepared us for even the greater things. Mm-hmm. So when you go into a regular college, four-year college, majoring in art, more than likely, you're going to exceed the basic level of the student coming in their freshman year as well.
Awesome.
So I changed. Oh, I'm sorry.
No, go right ahead.
Oh, I changed to biology.
Okay.
And following my mentor, Dr. William Howard Griffith, I wanted to be a doctor, so that's how I ended up changing in career path.
Okay. When we come back, we'll have more with William Michael Barbee. Hello and welcome back to We Are DeKalb TV. I'm your host, Heidi Fuller, and we have been having interesting conversation with Mr. William Barbee, sharing his testimony. William, we stopped talking at the last point about your medical career, about how you transitioned from being an artist into going into the medical field. Let's talk more about that.
Well, that transition came out of necessity.
Out of necessity.
I always heard about starving artists, and I knew quite a few.
Okay.
And I never wanted to be a starving artist, and then I always wanted to contribute within my family equally as my siblings did. They worked even though they were older, and I didn't put it in that perspective. So I changed to biology following my mentor, Dr. William Howard Griffith. Mm-hmm. He was a nephrologist who saw it not robbery to spend time with an inner city kid. Mm. And by him doing that, he was able to change my environment.
Yes.
And it was the first time. Now, we've had successes within the family, my aunts, uncles, so forth. But it was the first time I actually got to be up and close with a medical doctor who resembled me, or I resembled.
Mm-hmm.
And his wife was an executive at Bristol-Myers Pharmaceutical. So to be in their environment, then for him to entrust me, I wanted then to be more like him.
Yeah.
So even when I changed from the arts, did biology, and I, in my junior year, took the MCATs. I got into a medical program at University of Medicine Dentistry, program called Students for Medicine Dentistry, and I started following my mentor, Dr. William Howard Griffith.
So are you currently a mentor? Because we know how important it is to put yourselves in those positions to help young people. Do you mentor as well?
I mentor 24/7.
Wow.
While we're here on the way back, when we go to Tennessee, Nashville tomorrow morning, we're going to be coming back through whatever that highway is. And one of my mentees moved down here.
Okay.
And he's been going through transitions with his job. So while I'm down here, I'll stop in, surprise him with a visit.
Wow.
Just to encourage him.
Make sure you call first. Because we know how that can be. Yeah. You know, we also have another guest with us, Mr. James Womack, who I understand is a dear friend of yours, a business partner as well. Let's hear more from James today. Hey, Mr. Womack.
Hey.
What's been going on?
Oh, so many things.
So many things. Thank you for joining us here today on We Are DeKalb TV.
Thank you for having me. It's a pleasure to be here in Atlanta. As Mr. Mike Barbee shared with you, also a kid from the city of Newark, father, minister. Our families grew up in the Pentecostal church, so we were more like family growing up. Our parents went to school together, and we grew up in church together. And him also being a painter, I played saxophone, clarinet, oboe, and bassoon growing up as a kid, because my father thought that we should have a busy schedule. And he used to say, idle time is a devil's workshop.
Oh, yeah.
So weekends we had music lessons and chores around the house and cutting the grass and things like that. And later on, me being the oldest son, my father always said that, you know, I want you to have a real profession and not be out there begging and stealing and hanging with the wrong crowd. So my interest started very early in the forensic medicine funeral business. My dad was a dear friend of Mr. Orlando K. Perry, the founder of Perry Funeral Home in Newark. Mm-hmm. And I worked there in the summer and had some interest in, my expertise was making funeral arrangements with the families. I tried the embalming area and that wasn't really what I loved, so I was better interacting with families that were going through a time of depression and not understanding what to do at a time like that. So I mastered that, and then later on, got into the forensic medicine business by working at the Essex County Medical Examiner. And moonlighting there at night and working at the funeral home during the day and working funeral services. Did that for about 15 years. Went from United Hospital in Newark to Beth Israel. And in 1999, worked at University of Medicine Dentistry and had an opportunity to meet Lauren Hill. I was a guy that wore many hats, so while I was doing that, I was taking classes in massage therapy. So when Lauren Hill was doing the Miseducation of Lauren Hill, I had a day spa in Manhattan, and on weekends I would go there and do massages. And Lauren was at a studio called Chung King. Her dad called my place, and I went and worked under her. She convinced me to go into the music business and start a management company.
Wow.
So in 1999, I took a leave of absence from University of Medicine Dentistry, met Vincent Herbert, the guy who's married to Tamar Braxton and has Lady Gaga under his umbrella. We met through his brother Chris Herbert, and I was on the subway in New York, and I met a 16-year-old girl named Carly Blair Pariah, who had a 7-octave range, heard her sing, and of course, growing up in a church with music and family and singers, I had an ear for talent. So I met this girl and her parents, introduced her to Vincent Herbert. Babyface and Andre Harrell has started a label called New America Interscope. And Andre Harrell had just moved to New York in an apartment there. And Vincent heard the little girl. We went over, had her sing. 3 weeks later, I was living on Sunset Boulevard in LA with my first artist signed to Babyface's label. The girl was dropped because her mother was a stage mother and she was 16 years old, and Jimmy Iovine just didn't want to tolerate a stage mother. So they had to go home after we recorded 9 songs with some of the top producers in the business. I stayed in LA, determined to make it in the music business, was invited to a TV show called NBC's Most Talented Kids. And while sitting in the audience, I met a little 13-year-old girl from Foxbury, Massachusetts named JoJo. And after hearing her sing Respect on this show at a mere age of 13 with this big, soulful voice, I went and talked to her mother after the show, took them to lunch the next day, put her in the studio, called Vincent Herbert. We did a deal with Barry Hangerson, Black Ground Universal. JoJo became a very big pop star, toured with Usher in Europe, did 2 movies. We got her a sneaker endorsement deal. And then right after that, I met a songwriter from New Jersey that was 19 years old. He brought me 4 songs on a CD. I took it to Mary J. Blige's brother, and I got this kid a song placed on her No More Drama album. His name was Bryant Reeves. He wrote a song called Destiny. So I've been in LA since 2000. I'm now tapping into television production and looking to produce some TV shows. I'm working here along with my cousin and my friend with this business.
Yes.
And I've established a lot of relationships and friends in Hollywood. So now I'm able to bring value into what we're building.
Absolutely.
And, you know, at the end of the day, it's all about relationships, who you know and who knows you. And that's how the world really works.
And how did you guys meet?
Well, in church, our family.
In church.
Like, yeah, yeah.
And tell us about that church background. Tell us a little
well,
history.
You know, it's amazing. It's amazing because my dad was a Pentecostal preacher.
Okay.
Preached during the day, and on Sundays he was at church, but during the at night he worked for Eastern Airlines.
So now, was that the Five Baptized Holiness
Church?
That was
the Five Baptized Holiness Church where you couldn't wear makeup, you couldn't drink Coca-Cola, women had to wear dresses below
their knees, no jewelry,
no red.
It was, but you know what's really something about that? They still don't wear jewelry in the church. They still don't wear the lipstick in the church because, of course, as many of you guys don't know, that my great-grandfather established the Five Baptized Holiness Church of Americas. Mm-hmm. And what was really interesting is when James and I first had a chance to meet, that was a conversation that we had, and that just blew both of us away.
When I heard her last name was Fuller, and she told me she was
Bishop
from Atlanta,
yeah.
And we were at a gospel awards, Estella's, we met, we started talking. I was blown away that she was related to the late Bishop Fuller, who was an amazing man within himself.
Yes, yes.
But, you know, that's kind of where we are right now.
That's awesome. So, and you talked about growing up in the church as far as being an usher and doing some other great things. Did you guys, you attend church together?
Well,
we
fellowship
together.
Fellowship together.
Our churches, we had services together.
Actually, back then in the 70s, you had these dynamic choirs.
Right. Mm-hmm.
And we had a dynamic choir.
Of course.
Mm-hmm. The Womacks had a dynamic
exactly.
choir, the Simmons.
Absolutely.
So there was always competitiveness with relationship. So, or
healthy
when family members within the church get tired of Uncle Leonard preaching, they go to Uncle Donald. so
exactly.
That's the way we grew up, you know, mm-hmm. but it was a beauty, and it has kept this relationship. I'm 46
yes.
years old, so he's been here before me, so he's known me since I was a kid.
A little kid, absolutely.
A little kid, yeah. Wow. So you guys came back together when?
Actually, recently, I mm-hmm. came back from, I moved back to Jersey for a little while from L.A. to take care of my mom, who was 88 years old, who's suffering with dementia, so my brother and his wife called me, and I've been home 5 months now. Mm-hmm. We sat down and had a real conversation one day at the dining room table, and he said, you know, I'm doing this, that, and the other, and you have all these resources. Let's mm-hmm. pull together and make it
Absolutely.
Work. So we started doing that, and, you know, it's been great ever since.
Okay. Definitely. Well, we know how important it is to bring relationships together and people together to make it better for the common good of all. Mm-hmm. And I'm glad that you guys were able to come together and do such great things. But when we come back, we're going to talk more about your book. I want to talk about your being an entrepreneur and all the great things that you're working on and how James has been a great part of that. Okay?
Yes.
So when we come back, we'll have more here on WADTV. And welcome back to WADTV. I am here with two awesome men of God sharing great testimonies and great stories about where they've been and where they're going. James, you were mentioning a couple of artists that you had a chance to work with. And we were talking about getting into the industry and staying into the industry and why not being able to have that staying power. Let's talk a little bit about that.
Well, the business is set up where it's all about relationship. I actually have a managing company. It's called Strictly Entertainment. And the very first thing I had to learn is to be able to bring value into an artist's life. If you can't do that, then you can't really be a manager. A manager has to be a person that plugs you into different sources of television and music and producers and writers. So you learn that as you go along. There's no book that actually teaches you this. Many people read all you need to know about the music business and those, but it's really a hands-on journey.
Yes.
And a lot of times we'll turn on the radio or MTV or one of those networks, and you'll see this great artist that really could sing and has an amazing talent, and after 6 months you wonder what happened. Hmm. What happens is they bring in their cousin, Uncle Bubba, who used to work at the post office, and you can't have a guy that doesn't have experience in business sitting at a boardroom with a Jimmy Iovine or a Clive Davis who have made millions of dollars, and you're telling them what to do with their artists. Because it's all about being able to pick up the phone and connect people. I was fortunate enough to learn the business through Vincent Herbert, who's now one of the biggest moguls in the world, now producing television, married to Tamar Braxton. But he took me hands-on and walked me through the journey and introduced me to the Clive Davises and the L.A. Reeds and people like that. And I had to learn fast because once they hold your hand and take you inside, you have to learn quickly because they're not going to have time to take you and hang out with you and connect you. So you have to build your own relationships. It's all about how many people you know and how many people know you. And that's really how the business works.
So you're going to be great. You guys are going to be great partners in making sure
that.
Oh,
my God. Oh, yeah. Well, we were just in New York a week ago at the Circle of Sisters at the Jacob Javits Center in New York. And we had a chance to run into Corey from Coco Brothers.
Yeah.
He took pictures with us, so he's going to have him come on this show. And,
excellent.
M2Me, who produced music for years and now has a hot show on WBLS in New York. Liz Black, who's also a personality in New York. So we were able to connect with all these people while we're there and talk about the book and the movie and all those things. So it's all about relationship. And if you're young out there and you want to decide what you want to do with your life, surround yourself around people that are doing what you really want to do.
Say that again.
And you will learn. And if the people love you, they'll embrace you. And it's nothing like favor. The favor of God is the most important thing. Because when he gives you favor, it's better than money sometimes.
Yeah. Yes,
it'll
it
put
is.
You in places that you... I've sat with Michael Jackson and his mother. And I mean, a guy from Newark, New Jersey. I would never imagine ever meeting the people who I'm friends with. But it's the favor of God and my parents' prayers and people praying for me and all those good things.
Absolutely. Mm. Now, you talk about being able to promote and to position your clients into doing some great things. Let's talk about the book quickly. We talked about Clip Wings, They Do Fly. This is your latest book.
That's my latest book.
So we hope to see this everywhere, James.
You will.
Oh, yeah.
So tell us a little bit of history about this book. I understand that it came straight from your heart and that it is a fictional book?
It's fiction.
Okay, tell us about this.
Clip Wings, They Do Fly was birthed out of the concept of a broken wing bird that can't fly.
Okay.
And if you know a broken wing bird in the natural environment, he dies because his wings are his food, his escape from danger. That's what a bird uses his wings for. So my mom, who's in a wheelchair, I equated her with Clip Wings. Mm. And because she was debilitated, sometimes she got down on herself.
Okay.
But because of her children's successes, I would like to tell her often, and I still do, that she's flying because of us.
Wow.
And we're flying because of her.
Absolutely.
So Clip Wings, They Do Fly. To believe that that book is about the title, it's not. What I wanted to do with this book was take my personal experiences growing up when I had a psychotherapist, Dr. Shelley Nider, back for 2 years. With her back in 91, 92, I started writing poetry. And most of my poetry, I amassed maybe 200 pieces of poetry over a 2 year period. I look back on things, and what I found often when I'm speaking to kids today, or when I've heard other entrepreneurs or successful business owners speak, they only talk about the good.
Oh, yeah.
I wanted to focus on some of the struggles. So what I did, I went back and found my poems, and I found a fictitious character to hide my story in.
Okay.
So I built a story around a guy with multiple personality disorder who finds himself on trial for a crime he doesn't remember committing. And through that, I was able to put my personal experiences when I was in that dark spot, that dark space, and allow my poetry to speak in the language as if the character Billy Ray Michaels is sharing his story.
So your poetry was a therapy?
Yes, very therapeutic.
Very therapeutic.
It's one of my challenges.
So in writing, in even when you're feeling sad or depressed, or even when you're happy when you write, I feel that you can convey a lot of your feelings through writing, and sometimes you'll share those things and sometimes not.
Right.
And when you're very angry with people, I think that's a great idea to write it down.
Absolutely.
And then you can really figure out which direction you're going in, if I'm going to speak this out loud,
well,
if I'm going to throw it away.
How often have you heard oh man, I've been writing for years. I just didn't publish my book.
Oh yeah.
Oh, I have so much stuff. I've been putting notes all over. I just didn't publish it. Mm-hmm. You know, you hear that quite often.
And then you die with your dreams.
You die with every dream. And mm-hmm. I'm still that kid who dreams and have these visions.
Yes.
And that's where James is truly an asset to me.
Yes.
All my life I've watched James, and as he alluded to, things he had done working for the medical examiner.
Mm-hmm.
As a kid, we, in the black church, we've been to every kind of funeral. Mm-hmm. So when people die going in a funeral home, it wasn't a fearful thing because they were going to a better place.
Right.
While James was at, James and Craig and different ones in the family were at the Perry's funeral home working, we would go there and we were fascinated with dead bodies.
Wow.
So I remember as I started achieving these different things, I had bucket lists. Mm-hmm. And one of my bucket list items, own antique cars, did it. Retire at 35, did it.
Mm.
I don't like saying be a millionaire at 30, but you know, God has been good.
Praise
but
God.
I wanted to jump out of a plane, I did it.
Okay.
But the other one was to become a mortician.
Mm-hmm.
Not that I would ever practice as a career, so I went to school.
Mm-hmm. Right.
After I did a semi-retirement in 2002 and went to American Academy of Mortuary Science in Manhattan, which is the leading mortuary school
in the world. Exactly.
Wow. Yeah, it's the leading mortuary school in the country.
Yeah.
And I graduated vice president of my class in 2003 because that was a bucket list item, following behind James Womack, who was always out there in the forefront. We idolized James, my brother Mark and I.
Wow.
We looked up to James. So I saw value with James, even
Absolutely.
As the businesses went on. There's another friend, Timothy Ware, mm-hmm. who's in Greenville, South Carolina now, but he and James have similar characteristics mm-hmm. where they're able to tap in with their resources mm-hmm. to make your product and or services even better.
Absolutely.
So with that relationship, I saw much value in why I needed him mm-hmm. at this phase. Now, we've been here all our lives. Mm-hmm. I've watched him, he's watched me. But never once in all these years did we sit down to discuss how we can be of a blessing to the other.
But now is the season.
Today is our season, and we've been doing well.
It's wonderful. Yeah.
That's awesome. When you talked about bucket lists, I know one of our leading journalists, or excuse me, writers for our magazine talks about her bucket list and how important it is to have something like that. Have your lifelong goals written down. And I want to encourage our audience to make sure that you make a bucket list. Pull out a few things that you know that you'd like to accomplish or do within your lifetime and make sure that it happens. Because it makes your life richer.
Sure.
It makes you that really push you to do the things that you want to do and come to full fruition. You think about that,
That's
James.
Right. That's right. Absolutely.
Yeah, do you have a bucket list?
I did, yeah. I still do, but I've done so many things in my life.
Yes.
I was a guy that I was a photographer and I imported cars at 22 years old. I was the youngest black guy bringing Mercedes and BMW into the United States at 22 years old. Mm-hmm. I was doing about $50,000 a month at 22 years old.
Amazing.
I bought my first Rolls Royce at 24. Yeah, so I've had a wonderful life. I've traveled around the world. I've been everywhere.
I attest to that.
William, let's talk about some of your other companies that you have here. I understand you have Prestige Tours. Tell us a little bit about that.
Prestige Tours originated out of a company called Barbee & Associates Limousine Service, which was a combination of Barbee Richardson, my former partner, Dwayne Richardson, who would later become my partner again in the media industry.
Okay.
We started Barbee & Associates Limousine Service. That was back when we were in college. And the concept was that it would pay for school. After the first year, I bought them out the business. Kept the business, and Prestige is the name that we adapted maybe 14 years ago when we started with the charter buses and the school bus division. So now we're like a leading small to medium-sized company in New Jersey covering the metropolitan area, but also going to Canada, Florida, and the likes.
Wow.
So Prestige was the, Barrich & Associates, that one I started over 25 years ago. After that, I started United Care Medical Transportation Service, which was the ambulance service. As I mentioned earlier, I was working in the hospital. And my mentor, Dr. William Howard Griffith, encouraged me. He asked me, well, Mike, what are you doing? I said, well, I'm a chauffeur. He said, no, you're more than a chauffeur. You're a transportation executive.
There you go.
So I was like, what is this garbage, man? You know, I was like, transportation executive. But he started encouraging me to think big.
Absolutely.
And once I started thinking big, he said, well, you're taking us to the airport, you're doing our daughter's wedding, and you're doing the security guards' proms of their children, and taking them to the airport and doing their weddings. So why not transport the patients? So at the time, I was working at East Orange General Hospital, which is a beautiful institution. I'm on the board there 12 years now at that as a trustee at that hospital. But working there, I applied to the state of New Jersey and got my license to start the ambulance service. You need to transition.
Go on.
Okay, to start the ambulance service.
I'm sorry.
And the United DeKalb was formed, medical transportation service started 17 years ago.
Okay.
The monies I made with that, I bought, as I mentioned, the office building, which was across the street from the welfare hotel in which I once lived. That money, along with the ambulance, the limos and charter bus, I was able to start Prestige Media Productions, which is a media company by which is birthing a lot of young talent out here in the world. With Prestige Media, we're able to produce commercials, documentaries, movies. We're doing our first, well, our second movie project at this time. And one of the reasons why we're here in Atlanta is not only to promote positive images of saved young men, but also to take care of business while we're here.
Okay, let's talk more about that when we come back. When we come back, we'll talk more about the great things that you have going on here in Atlanta, what we can look forward to, and how we can get in touch with you. So stick around for more of We're DeKalb TV. And welcome back to We're DeKalb TV. I'm your host, Heidi Fuller, and I hope that you guys have enjoyed the show today. We've learned a lot about the film and music industry from these two great gentlemen, and I want to know more, just a little bit more about what you guys are doing in regards to how you handle your success as well as your failures, because we know how important that is. We, like you both have mentioned, we always see people at their height. So what was the thing that kept you going throughout it all? We know that God kept you going,
right?
But along with that, what were some of your pitfalls and how did you overcome that?
Okay, I think from early on, just being able to be creative, being without, learning how to make best with what you have.
Absolutely.
And that secondhand furniture concept really started applying itself to life. So I always began to think outside the box and be creative, not only just from an artistic perspective, so even from a business perspective. So with doors closed, like even with the media company, as we built this company, my partner Dwayne Spence Richardson and I built this company, many doors closed every time we go to see what we could do. So what it forced us to do was to own our own cameras.
Say it.
Our own lighting.
Right.
Our own audio. Own studio. And then people now coming to us, but it's because we realized that we need to create, produce, direct. And that's what led us into the movie, Clip Wings, They Do Fly, as well as the other stuff. So we've seen the obstacles, but we've learned how to walk through the doors even when they close.
And your childhood, I'm sure, lend a lot to that, like you mentioned.
Mostly, yeah.
Being without makes you really appreciate having.
Sure.
Mr. Womack.
Well, just 2.5 years ago, I came back to New Jersey from L.A., and I lost my younger brother to a heart attack, my baby brother, and when I came home to bury him, I was actually diagnosed with diabetes. It was 12 degrees. I hadn't been in that kind of cold weather in a long time living in California. And my other brother found me on his living room floor on my face. I went to a diabetic coma, and my sugar level was 1158. So when I got, now this was right after losing my younger brother, when I got to the emergency room, the doctors told my family that there's no way I would live. There's no way I would, they had never seen a patient with a sugar level that high. My whole body was white like someone took talcum powder and sprinkled it all over me. The acidity from my pores came outside my skin.
Wow.
So I was in a coma for 4 days, and when I actually woke up, the doctors cleared the room and stood around the bed and said, "You must believe in God, because there's no way that you should be talking. You should be blind, your liver and kidneys should be damaged, and you may have complications." And I said to them, "God isn't ready to take me home yet. I'm gonna live, I got more to do.
I got more
hurdles to climb and more mountains to climb." And one of the nurses came to the room and said, "I just wanna know who you are, because I've been here 20 years, I've never met a guy that had so many phone calls and visitors. You are loved around the world."
Yes.
And it's amazing. So you can't leave yet. So I know that faith in God is the most important thing.
Yes, it is.
Having a relationship with God is key. And if you really believe in faith and have faith, there's nothing you can overcome.
Nothing.
Absolutely nothing.
Nothing.
I'm that a living awesome. Witness. I would never imagine the people I've met and the people I've sat with and people in front. It's just unbelievable where life will take you.
Yes, it is. Yeah. So, William, how can we get in touch with you?
We can be reached at barbeegroup.com, BarbeeGroup.com, PrestigeMediaProductions.com, RidePrestige.com, Airmig Counseling Services, AirmigCounseling.com. And even the book itself has its own website, clippedwingsdeydofly.com. Those are ways you can reach us, or you can call us at our office, 973-678-3022. We're here for you, and we would love to work. We're waiting for that phone to ring. We'd like to service you in some way.
So you're continuing to, are you looking for projects? Is that what you're saying?
We accept projects as they come across the desk. Mm-hmm. My hands are full, but you know, my cup still, you know, God continues to bless me. He provides me. He never sends me out unprepared.
Okay.
So we're still putting out a good product, even though we have many artists and people and missions to mm-hmm. fulfill. So.
And you mentioned a YouTube piece. Which was on there?
YouTube. On YouTube, you have excerpts from a movie that we're filming now.
Okay.
You'll be able to find on YouTube, Clip Wings, They Do Fly is actually a movie trailer mm-hmm. on YouTube for the book itself.
Okay.
And then you have clips that we have yet to release to the public, but we will allow your station to have first hands at some of the flashbacks of the character Billy Ray Michaels as he reflects from Martin Luther King's assassination when he was a kid back to 1968, running the streets as a little boy throwing really water balloons. So there'll be other clips that you'll be able to see.
Excellent. Well, thank you. We'll be glad to share that with everyone.
God bless.
And also, if you are an independent artist that has a budget and you need a music video shot, or if you have a budget and you're with the major labels, his company can also do music videos at an affordable price, and you would think that you spend $100,000 to have this video done. That's how well produced they are. So
that's where that creativity comes in.
Absolutely.
And being able to pull from your resources and make it work for you. How about that?
Absolutely.
Well, any closing remarks? I would like for you to share something awesome with our audience, because I know you both have something to share.
Believe in your dreams. Keep God first. With faith, all things are possible. Develop relationships and channel those relationships and make them grow. You'll be amazing where God can take you.
Mr. Barbee?
I've always been a big proponent of the smaller man, and the way I've always saw myself as a kid until I come to celebrate the beauty of who William Michael Barbee is. But one thing that I've always learned is to leave more than you take, and that's a slogan that I tell everyone everywhere I go. Far too often we're about greed, greed, greed. We always see what we could get for ourselves. But it's more important to bless others and allow God to bless you. He can't bless you if your hand is tight, closed, and you're taking. So leave more than you take.
That is awesome. Great, great advice from two awesome men of God. And I thank you again for joining us here today on We Are DeKalb TV. And I hope to see you guys again real soon.
Thank you
for having
me.
So let us know your next event so we can be a part of that. And thank you guys for joining us here today on We Are DeKalb TV.